Good afternoon, everyone. And thanks, Nikhil and Dilip Bhatt Foundation for arranging this talk. My name is Dipankar. I work with WWF India. And today, I have the privilege of introducing a colleague of mine, Dr. Rishi Kumar Sharma, who would be talking about Ghost of the Mountains, Spirit of the Mountains. Rishi actually started his career, although he is a domicile of the newly declared Union Territory of J&K, which is also one of the major snow leopard areas in our country. He actually started his research career on tigers. And for some time he was in central India with some fascinating tiger work. And then he started his PhD in Himachal Pradesh in the Upper Spiti Valley, where he pioneered some of the snow leopard research actions, and some of which we will hear today. I'm not going to talk about Rishi and snow leopards, but more about Rishi. I think Rishi is more than a scientist among us, because generally scientists would talk in a language which naturalists wouldn't understand. And about 5-6 years back, when Rishi was picking up his work in WWF India, he is the lead for snow leopard conservation for WWF India. He is also the lead for snow leopard conservation in WWF International. So whatever conservation work on snow leopards is taking place by WWF countries across the snow leopard habitats, Rishi is the mastermind who is designing the studies, who is designing conservation actions. So when Rishi started about six years back with this revamped role, the first thing he did was simplifying some of the scientific findings of snow leopard conservation, of what's happening in snow leopard habitats, and how one needs to address some of the conservation concerns. Now, until and unless we simplify some of the scientific outcomes, until and unless we talk about research outcomes in a language which is understandable by a common person, by a stakeholder who lives in a snow leopard habitat, things don't work well. So Rishi has that knowledge, and he inspires us to go to the field, look at a habitat, of course, look at a snow leopard, but also look at the snow leopard habitat and then see what needs to be done. I won't take much time. Over to you, Rishi. Before Rishi starts, I would request everyone to kindly mute their microphones and switch off their videos. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Thanks, Dipankar, for the kind introduction. And thanks to Dilip Bhatt Foundation for this opportunity to speak about snow leopards. So while we were discussing about this particular talk, I was wondering what I should actually talk about, because we have a broad, wider audience who have more general interests. So I didn't want to really focus on one particular aspect of snow leopard or their conservation. So I've kept it a little general so that it should be interesting to everyone. And definitely, if there is something that I don't cover and something that you are interested in, we'll have a Q&A session where you could ask any questions that you would like to pose. So well, without much ado, so I thought I'll speak about what do we know about snow leopards in our country, in the Indian Himalayas specifically, and what are we doing actually to conserve snow leopards? And I'll also speak a little bit about what do we know about the species itself from the knowledge and science that have been happening in the species range for several years now, in fact, several decades now, which have picked up the pace a little more recently. So while my talk is titled as The Ghost of the Mountains, I'll come to it later, why call it The Ghost of the Mountains. But just to clarify, the snow leopards in our own Indian parlance or in our own culture, they are referred to as the Spirit of the Mountains, because this is a species which is very closely linked to the high mountain systems, the people who are living there, the spiritual aspects of the mountains. So if you talk to local people in the Indian Himalayas, for many of them, especially people from the Buddhist cultures, a snow leopard sort of embodies the spirit of the mountain systems, right? One second. Okay, so as you can see here, this is a snow leopard indeed, and you can see it's a very stark image. You see a beautiful snow leopard in the foreground. There is a camera trap, which is attached to a stone kind of structure. This is typically how we study snow leopards, because they are very rare and difficult to sight in the wild. And in the background, you can see really, again, really stark and barren kind of mountains. They're apparently barren. They in fact aren't. They're very productive, and they harbor a very rich assemblage of wildlife. So what actually is a snow leopard? Snow leopard is one of the Panthera species, one of the five big cats. It's in fact the smallest of all the five big cats in the Panthera genus. And recent genetic work shows earlier snow leopard was placed in its own genus called as Ansia Ansia. Now it's called as Panthera Ansia. The reason being that the more recent genetic studies show that snow leopards are in fact more closely related to tigers than any other big cat. So while it's called a snow leopard, it's in fact more closely related to tigers genetically. And being a snow leopard, typically it's obviously very well adapted to the high mountains in which it lives. It has very specialized features to be able to take down its prey in the really rugged and difficult kind of mountain terrain. The coat of a snow leopard is very thick. It's very thick and furry, so it's very well insulated. And obviously with a cat that has evolved in these very high mountains for millions of years, it has developed several anatomical and physiological adaptations to be able to survive in that high altitude, low oxygen kind of environment. I'll talk about those a little bit in detail a little later. So globally, this is where snow leopards are found. I hope you can see my cursor moving. So this is the snow leopard range. The blue shade that you see, this is where we know for sure that snow leopards are present. And the brownish shade is somewhere where their presence is a little unknown. They have been seen seasonally, but sometimes some people claim they have been sightings. Other people say, no, they aren't there. So this is how the distribution is. In fact, in the Central and South Asia, snow leopards are found in about 12 countries, right from the Western Himalayas here in JNK and Pakistan here, right up to the Eastern Himalayas. So at least in the Indian Himalayas, if you look at the India part, it kind of follows the Himalayan arc. That's how the snow leopards are distributed in the three states of Jammu and Kashmir, Uttarakhand and Himachal in the Western Himalayas, and Sikkim and Arunachal in the Eastern. So the total range of snow leopards globally is about 1.8 million square kilometers. So it's a very widely distributed species, but that creates an illusion that it's in a very large range, so it must be doing fine. But biologically, it's a very rare species. In fact, even in the best quality habitats, the snow leopard densities typically are as low as one snow leopard per 100 square kilometers. So those of you who know more about big cats and tigers especially, just to contrast, in good quality tiger habitats in India, the tiger densities can go up to even 20 tigers per 100 square kilometers. So that's a stark difference between these two cats. Snow leopards are truly really, really rare. As I was mentioning, snow leopards are really well adapted to live in these high mountain systems. They have certain morphological features. For instance, they have very long hide limbs to be able to jump in the difficult mountain terrain in which they live. A snow leopard's tail is very long and flexible. You can see in this picture the image that the tail is thick and long and very prominent. So this flexible tail actually allows snow leopards to balance while negotiating the really treacherous terrain in the mountains. And snow leopards also have very well-developed chest and nasal cavity. That's an adaptation to the low oxygen environment of the Himalayas. And they have very thick and stocky forelimbs. And if you can see in this image again, if you look at the forepaws, they are really broad and wide. So that's an adaptation for snow leopards to be able to walk in thick and deep snow. So similarly, because they live in these high cold mountains, they have again specialized adaptations to be able to survive in that kind of terrain and that kind of environment. As I was mentioning, the snow leopard's tail is long and furry. And you may find it funny, but snow leopards also use it like a muffler to wrap it around their face in severe winters. So it provides warmth. And snow leopard pelage, or you know, their fur is one of the densest fur amongst any of the cat species. There are about 4,000 hair per square centimeter in the snow leopard's fur. So these are some of the features that really enable snow leopards to live in the cold and arid and difficult high mountain terrain. So just like other cats, snow leopards are again solitary. They live alone except for a short window of time when mating happens. Then you will see male and females together. Usually the litter size is about 1 to 5 cubs. And the gestation period is about 90 to 100 days. So I'm mentioning 1 to 5 cubs, that's a range, but typically in the wild, there are usually 2 or 3 cubs. And even if there is a larger litter of 4 to 5 cubs, usually only 2 or 3 will survive given the kind of harsh terrain they live in. And snow leopards, like most other big cats, are more active in the early morning and late evening hours. So snow leopards typically feed on these high mountain ungulates that includes mainly blue sheep, argali, and ibex, but they also feed on smaller prey, including lagomorphs and birds, such as Tibetan snowcock. Snow leopards are they're not a specialized predator. They're also a bit opportunist. And that also gets them in trouble at times. For instance, if you look at snow leopard diet, almost 20 to 70% of snow leopard diets is a variation indeed across the larger snow leopard range, but up to 70% of snow leopard diet can actually come from livestock. And that fact puts snow leopards in conflict with people who own that livestock, the traditional herding communities in the Himalayas and the snow leopard range elsewhere. I'll talk a little bit more about that a little later. And as I was mentioning, it's a very rare species. So one of the challenges that biologists across the snow leopard range in all the 12 countries have been facing, not just biologists, in fact, the governments who are interested in snow leopard conservation, is to have a reliable estimate of snow leopard population density. Now that seems pretty straightforward to do because now we have technology, now we have tools, camera traps have become cheaper, and more reliable indeed. And so if you want, you could invest in camera traps and cover large areas and survey snow leopards. So why has that not happened? So a related fact to this is that if you look at the global snow leopard range, less than about 5% snow leopard range has reliable estimates of snow leopard population size. By reliable, I mean estimates derived from more acceptable tools and techniques like camera trapping and genetics. There are other kind of surveys which are more to do with the species occupancy and presence absence. They are different, but robust estimates of snow leopard populations are quite low across the snow leopard range. The challenge specifically with snow leopards is they are very, very rare and they are cryptic and they're very difficult to sample. In fact, I must say that snow leopard is a very typical example of a very difficult to survey, a very difficult to sample carnivore species, a big cat species. And that's not helped by the fact that the snow leopard terrain is remote, it's rugged, these are high mountain systems, and working there is indeed difficult because there are limitations, physical limitations, physiological limitations imposed by high altitudes and the lack of oxygen in that kind of an environment. So what is the problem? Why we But then, I mean, the development of technology and tools should still help us. We now know the methods, we know the tools and techniques. So I just wanted to show this picture to you to illustrate the problem of serving snow leopards. And also the fact that as a species, it's really well camouflaged in the terrain in which it lives. You may walk in a mountain for several kilometers and you may actually be very close to a snow leopard. A snow leopard might be right next to a ledge or across the slope to you, but you may not see it because they're very well camouflaged. So yeah, so in this image, if you look at this one, can any of you sight a snow leopard? I'll leave you with about 5 seconds to figure out where the snow leopard is, and then I'll reveal where it is actually. There is a snow leopard in this picture indeed. Okay, so you see the red circle here? That's where the snow leopard is. It's a subadult animal. And as you can see, you can also see 3 blue sheep in the foreground. And it's very interesting. They're all looking in a different direction, you know? And snow leopard is right up there hiding, camouflaged, really mingled and merged with the terrain in which it lives. It's very, very hard to spot it. So I won't be, if you have spotted it, you have really great eyes. If you haven't, don't feel disappointed. Because even the prey species here, which is blue sheep, whose survival is actually dependent on their ability to detect a snow leopard in time, have no clue where the snow leopard is, right? So this is just to illustrate how well camouflaged and difficult to sight they are. Okay, and I also wanted to show you how difficult it is for snow leopards also to hunt their prey. So this is a short film which has been taken by Wild Films India. So I'll just play it and you can see how snow leopards typically hunt in their high mountain terrain. 1 second. It's about 2 minutes, so it won't be long. Okay, so you see, it illustrates the kind of terrain these snow leopards live in. It shows you how difficult it is for snow leopards to hunt, but it also brings very clearly the kind of terrain snow leopards are living in. And you know how desperate that snow leopard must be, how hungry it must be that it took such great risk actually to capture its prey. And it also is an illustration of how well adapted this animal is to this terrain, that despite such a fall where anyone else would have broken multiple limbs, a snow leopard is hanging on. It's still capturing its prey. And in fact, if you play around this video in a slow motion mode, you will see how snow leopard is actually maneuvering its prey midair. So that's a kind of adaptation and how well snow leopards have adapted to the high mountains. That's what I wanted to illustrate. And this is how a typical snow leopard habitat looks. So I wanted to bring home the point that for snow leopards and high mountain wild ungulates and the wildlife in the high Himalayas to survive, the most fundamental important thing is the grasslands, or what we also called as rangelands. So in the Himalayan rain shadows, the rangelands are about 2.6 million square kilometers. And this is how a typical rangeland system looks like. This is in the eastern Himalayas, which is slightly more greener. The tree line goes further up. I mean, if you look at the western Himalayas, the tree line stops at about 3,000 meters. But in the eastern Himalayas, at times it can go even up to 4,000 meters. So it's slightly greener and it illustrates how it looks in the Eastern Himalayas. And this is how stark and different it can look in the Western Himalayas. So these are the systems. And again, if you look at this image, so to an untrained eye, it looks like a kind of lump of cold, barren mountains. But you only have to look closer to see how teeming they are with wildlife and how rich they are in high mountain wildlife species. So, okay. So the grassland systems or the rangeland systems, which are also popularly called as alpine areas, they form about 33% of the Himalayas. And if we look at the Trans-Himalaya system, which is more than 3,000 meters, there it's the dry vegetation kind of. So below that in the alpine zone, you find more moist kind of vegetation. So that's a gradient that you see within the Himalayas beyond 3,000 meters in the alpine zone. And needless to say, it's a very rich kind of region. It has multiple values. So this is another aspect which I wanted to highlight. So this region is not just barren mountains and snow leopards. It has immense values. It has immense cultural values. There are several kind of pastoral, agro-pastoral communities that live in this in the Himalayas. They have their own rich traditions and history. Of course, I was mentioning that it's rich in wildlife. It has cultural and spiritual values. And increasingly, it has value for people who are seeking adventure, who want to go and see wildlife. There is also a rise in tourism in the Himalayas, which is more related to wildlife sighting, being away from the plains of Delhi or the heat of Delhi. So it's picking up and it brings its own set of challenges and pressures. And for the local people, of course, Himalayas do not only help them rear livestock, which is their most precious commodity, but they also sustain them through some bit of agriculture, which local people rely on and have their own local crops. And this region has a very rich history of pastoralism. And people and wildlife have been living together in this terrain for several millennia. And this is what kind of differentiates the Himalayan region from the rest of the country. So if you look at the status of protect wildlife in the mainland India or the rest of India, you see that wildlife is mostly restricted to the island of protected areas. The moment you go beyond a protected area, the wildlife population will either considerably decline or you will actually not see anything, because then you will find very intense agriculture or industries or towns or villages. But in the Himalayas, there is a contiguity. So there are no areas where you do not see wildlife. So people and wildlife are living together. Of course, there is variation in terms of certain areas will have much higher population density of wildlife than other areas, depending on the pressures. But this contiguity remains. It's not broken by any kind of artificial barriers. And indeed, it's a wildlife heaven. And as it's the high Himalayan zone, it has its own very rich and unique assemblies of wildlife species. So on the left side, you see Kiang, an image taken from Ladakh. So, and this is the Indian Himalayas is one of the region which still have very large herd of wild ungulates, the parallel of which is only seen in the Tibetan Plateau and nowhere else. So we really have a rich heritage of unique high mountain species in the Himalayas. And of course, there are challenges. These species, including the apex species, which is a snow leopard, they are living in edge. There are multiple problems, including habitat degradation and loss, the impacts of climate change, a lot of increasing tourism pressures. And of course, the local socioeconomy of the region is also changing. It has its own bearing and impacts on the wildlife of the region. And there is some bit of hunting and poaching also that goes on. But the biggest problem, if I have to point out, is the human-wildlife conflict. And I'll come to that a little later for a bit of detailing. And what do we know from our current knowledge about snow leopards? So if you So this also is to illustrate why snow leopard conservation is different. So if you see, less than 6% of the snow leopard range or snow leopard habitat is actually under formal protected areas, which means more than 90% of the snow leopard range is outside of the protected areas. So what do you do in a scenario like that? How do you conserve a species whose range is overlapping with people all across the world? So that's a situation that snow leopards live in. And even the protected areas that we have in the snow leopard range, now this is a global figure, there are about 170 protected areas in the snow leopard range. About 40% of those protected areas are actually smaller than the home range of a single adult male snow leopard. So you can imagine for a wide-ranging species which can have a home range of about 300 square kilometers to right up to 1500 square kilometers. The size of protected areas that you require is very different from what the size of a protected area would look like for another species. And as I mentioned earlier, we have very little information about the population size of the snow leopards from across their range. So another fact is that between 200 to 450 snow leopards are killed annually, illegally, they are poached. And the worrying fact is that out of these snow leopards that are killed annually, about more than 50% are actually killed in retaliation for livestock predation by snow leopards. As I was mentioning earlier, more than 60 to 70% of snow leopard diet can come from livestock. And this livestock is owned by local communities. And when snow leopards kill that livestock, people sometimes retaliate and kill snow leopards. This is one of the larger challenges for snow leopard conservation, actually. How do you reconcile people's livelihood, people's dependence on livestock with snow leopard conservation? Can you do both? That's a question that we have to ask. So one of the important aspects of conservation indeed is the knowledge about the species, its habitat. So for any effective conservation program, for any effective conservation model, the first thing we need to know is, what do we know about the species? Do we understand the threats? Do we understand the habitat need of the species? So this map illustrates what do we really know about snow leopards in our country. So this is a synthesis, a summary of all the existing knowledge that we have about snow leopards in our country. So if you see in the Western Himalayas here, you see two red kind of hotspots. So it indicates more research, more number of studies that have happened here. And the bluish color is about 0 to 1 studies, you know, very few studies, a couple of surveys perhaps. So if you see in our country, despite several decades of research on snow leopards, there are just two hotspots of snow leopard research. One is, of course, the Hamis National Park on the extreme upper left corner. And the second one is Spiti Valley in the state of Himachal. So these two are the regions where bulk of snow leopard research has happened. But the worrying fact is, if the moment you look beyond these two hotspots, this Hamis and Spiti Valley, you see that there's very little information about snow leopards from the Indian Himalayas. So in fact, speaking quantitatively, less than 20% of snow leopard range in our country has been covered by any form of research or conservation action. That means more than 70-80% of snow leopard range remains unsurveyed, unexplored. And if you look at the quality of information that can actually help you take any kind of conservation management decisions, so good quality information about snow leopards that can actually help you take good decisions about future, about conservation, comes from about less than 5% of the snow leopard range. So that's the kind of situation we right now are in, so far as the knowledge about snow leopards is concerned. And we are in this situation due to a range of factors, as I was mentioning earlier. One, of course, is that these are very difficult kind of terrains to work in. It's hard to work there. You need long-term commitment. You need much higher resources and logistics to invest in to work in these high mountains. And the second challenge, of course, is the remoteness of these areas. Not everyone wants to go there and live a secluded kind of life. And third one is, of course, relatively less interest in snow leopards. While most people know about the challenges for conservation for tigers, for instance, or even elephants to some extent, or even rhinos to some extent, because there is greater awareness about these species, about the plight of these species. That awareness is a little low for snow leopards. So there is relatively less interest, which now is picking up indeed. So that's a good change that we are seeing now. And also, as I was mentioning earlier, the point I was emphasizing is that because snow leopards literally live with people across their range, so if you really have to conserve them, you have to find a way where you can not only help snow leopards, but also work with local communities, help people also to help you conserve snow leopards. So you need an element of engaging with communities to have stewardship from the local communities for snow leopard conservation. In fact, I must say, snow leopard conservation is not possible unless you really partner with and work very closely with the local communities in the snow leopard range. But from the knowledge point of view, again, a very worrying fact is that if you look at this figure, it plots the trajectory of snow leopard research in our country. So if you see from 1940s onward, interest in snow leopard research has picked up, in fact. And you see a pretty good growth in the number of studies on snow leopards in our country, almost an exponential growth. But if you look at the research in the human dimensions of conservation, research into the livelihood of local communities, how they're coping with climate change, what is their relationship with nature and snow leopards, what do they think about wolves and snow leopards, would they want to conserve them, will they kill it if they kill their livestock? So they are very important conservation questions. So research into those dimensions has been dismally low. So that's illustrated by these brown kind of bars in this figure. You see, while ecological research has picked up, by ecological research, I mean mostly research on the distribution of snow leopards, their food habits, their population size, that has gone up. But the research in the human dimensions of conservation has been very poor, and that needs to really change. So related to this point is, why is it important? Why I'm mentioning these points? So it is why it is important to understand the human dimensions of conservation, specifically in case of snow leopards. So I'll just reiterate some of those points here. One, as I mentioned earlier, if you look at the snow leopard range, less than 6% of snow leopard range is under protected areas. More than 90% of the snow leopard range is outside PAs. And across the snow leopard range, globally and in the Indian Himalayas as well, snow leopards and people are literally like living together, because these are all agro-pastoral, pastoral and nomadic communities. And their primary occupation, their backbone of the local economy is in fact livestock. So they are raiding livestock all over the Himalayas. So there's a large interface between people and local communities across this region. And that has a tremendous influence on snow leopards. Also because snow leopards have a relationship with them, they kill their livestock, so they share interface, okay? So I just wanted to show this figure to illustrate how snow leopards can fare depending on the local conditions. So this is one landscape. What you see in front of your eyes is the Upper Spiti landscape, okay? And the different colors you see here illustrate the variation in snow leopard densities. So the darker shades indicate higher snow leopard densities, and the lighter shades show relatively and progressively less snow leopard density. Why there is such a variation in snow leopard density in one single landscape? So if you look, the density of snow leopards in this region is varying between 0.22, which is really low, 0.22 per 100 square kilometers, to about one snow leopard per 100 square kilometers. So that's a variation you see, and that variation is due to multiple factors. It has to do with the kind of terrain. It has to do with the pressures of livestock grazing. It has to do with the actual number of wild ungulate prey available to snow leopards. And while we speak about anthropogenic pressures very generically, in fact, in the Himalayas, the human population density is quite low actually. So human population size, or what we often referred to as anthropogenic pressures, should not have tremendous impact on snow leopards. But what is important is to differentiate between the kind of human pressures. So a place can have, two places can have similar kind of human population densities, But what people are actually doing there is what have an impact on snow leopards. So in this case, what you see in this figure, there was a very clear relationship between snow leopards, wild ungulate densities, and livestock densities. So in these blocks that you see here, wherever you have very high livestock densities, the wild ungulate densities were low, and so was the snow leopard density. So that's the relationship between snow leopards, wild ungulates, and livestock. So that's a cycle you have to look at if you have to really think hard about snow leopard conservation. So given the problems, given the challenges, given what we really know about snow leopards, or rather the lack of knowledge that we still have so far as snow leopards are concerned, so what are we doing now to conserve snow leopards in the Indian Himalayas? So one is we are working very closely with the local communities across the snow leopard range. And I must say, we are not just working with them, we are effectively partnering with them in many ways. Because if, as I mentioned earlier, snow leopard conservation is impossible unless you really respect and partner with local communities. And our partnership goes beyond just talking to them and getting them on board. What we are effectively doing is co-developing a knowledge, because these traditional herding communities who have been living in these mountains for several millennia, they have a very rich repertory of their own traditional ecological knowledge. Knowledge not just about the mountains and its vegetation and their livestock, but knowledge also about the wildlife, about snow leopards and wolves and blue sheep. So we are co-opting people, understanding and gaining from their knowledge, and blending that with more formal science, more formal approaches to do science, to really have effective planning for snow leopard conservation. And what this has achieved, at least in the Eastern Himalayas for us, is now there are at least 3,000 to 4,000 square kilometers of area in the state of Arunachal Pradesh that communities have voluntarily declared as community conservation areas, and they are protecting their forests as well as their wildlife. Similarly, as I mentioned earlier, snow leopards kill livestock, and people do get angry because it's their livelihood. So they also kill snow leopards at times. So to remedy that problem, what we are doing is we are developing something called as predator-proof corrals. So you see in this, if you see in this image, you see this structure. This is a typical livestock stocking pen. In fact, you can see some livestock here. So what happens is that traditional corrals are made in a manner that they are permeable to snow leopards. Snow leopards can easily break into those. And once a snow leopard enters a traditional kind of corral, it can kill several livestock heads in one go, though it might eat just one or two. And that's the kind of damage that an impoverished family living up high in the mountains, already in a harsh kind of environment, difficult to live in environment, can't take. So what we are doing is we are simply strengthening these structures. You can see this wire mesh up there and the reinforced door, which actually prevent snow leopards and wolves from entering these corrals so that the livestock is protected. That also helps communities in many ways, because then communities can also sleep in peace, you know, assured that their livestock is safe. We are also changing the narrative on the rangelands, because even now in several government policy documents, the rangelands are looked upon and treated as wastelands. There's a notion that any land which doesn't have tree is a unproductive land, it's not useful, it needs to be changed. And that's a very dangerous notion, because rangelands are very important and unique systems. And as I said, they are very rich in their own unique kind of wildlife, which is not found anywhere else. So we need to change that policy narrative and notion that people have about rangeland systems. And we're working at state and national level to change that narrative with policy implications. Also, we are partnering, of course, local communities are our main core partners, but we are also working very closely with all stakeholders who have stake in snow leopard conservation. And that does include Indian Army to a very large extent, because of course, in the Himalayan area, wherever we have snow leopards, these are all border areas. So they also have presence of armed forces, and armed forces are very keen to support conservation. They, in fact, have an ecocell whose mandate is to conserve biodiversity. So we are working closely with them also, engaging them, educating them, partnering with them to help conserve small leopards and high altitude wildlife. We're also providing policy support to mountain states, especially on issues related to tourism and its impact, and to see how tourism can be potentially done in a more sustainable manner. And indeed, one of our pillars to do this all logically is to use the best of science, use the best of knowledge to really have informed conservation planning for snow leopards. So that's what we are focusing on. So we have three or four pillars. I'm just reiterating them. One is to really work closely and partner with local communities and leverage their traditional ecological knowledge, blend that knowledge with our formal Western science to develop better snow leopard conservation strategies, change the policy narrative about snow leopard habitats and make sure they are not looked upon as wastelands and you know, these dry high altitude areas which are not useful. And third is to use good science to develop good conservation plans. So that's pretty much what I wanted to talk about. I think I've taken about 40, 45 minutes. So happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Rishi.
We have now opened the chat for questions.
Sure. I think one chat came already. So Rishi, there is a question from Mr. Kiran Srivastava, who is asking, what is a typical day for a researcher? Is it scanning the terrain at fixed points or working long hours?
Yeah, thanks for asking that. Actually, I in fact missed mentioning that in my presentation. Thank you very much. Yeah, so typically a day for a researcher in this terrain, it's almost like an expedition. So you really start early in the morning and before the sun rises, and you have to be back in the camp before the sunset. And because it's all remote snow leopard habitats, and at times wherever you have hamlets and villages, we feel very grateful because then you can use those, you can seek help from local people. But in much of the range, you don't even have people and hamlets. So there you do it in an expedition mode, and it typically involves walking 12 to 15 kilometers on an average on a daily basis. So just to illustrate the difference, it's not really scanning slopes from fixed points. So that's done at certain point of time. It usually is walking long distances throughout the day to cover as much terrain as you can in a day, because all kinds of surveys, whether you're looking at snow leopard signs, whether you're installing camera traps, require that you walk long distances because there is no other option. This is a wide-ranging species, and the terrain is such that walking is the best and the only viable option, except for if you're in Mongolia where people use horses. They are lucky to have that.
Thanks, Rishi. The second question is about, I think two persons have asked about this, is that have they been tagged to track movements? So anything on collaring or tagging?
Yeah, so the first snow leopard collaring happened by Dr. Rodney Jackson in Nepal in 1970s. And now if you look at the state of snow leopard collaring, there are about 30 snow leopards radio collared in Mongolia. We do not have any radio collared snow leopards in India anywhere, though Dr. Raghu Chindawat had done collaring of snow leopards in Ladakh, perhaps in the 90s, if I'm not mistaken. So we do not have radio collared snow leopards in India as we speak. But globally, there is more and more collaring happening. Nepal has about 10 to 12 collared snow leopards.
Rishi, what about the radio collaring done by the JNK Wildlife Department in Ladakh, erstwhile Ladakh?
I think they have started on a collaring project, but I'm not very well aware of how many snow leopards they have collared or what's the state of that project as of now.
Okay,
but
there, there is a lot of thank yous pouring in. So I think somebody asked, how many snow leopards have you sighted in your career span, Rishi?
Oh, that's a great question. So I spent 5 years walking about 15 to 20 kilometers per day in the Western Himalayas, while during my PhD work on snow leopards. And I have seen snow leopard only 3 times in this duration of 5 years. And they were all fleeting glimpses. Okay. I could never sit back, relax, and see a snow leopard for more than 30 seconds.
So that brings to the next question, is that what is the current estimated population for snow leopards in the world and in India?
The current estimate of snow leopard population globally is between 4,000 to 7,000 snow leopards. And in India, it's between 200 to 600. But the point that that's a great question, and thanks for asking that. So the important point to notice here is, you look at a wide range of this estimate. So for global estimate, it says between 4,000 to 7,000. And for India, it's between 200 to 600. What does it mean? It actually doesn't mean anything. I mean, it's so off the mark. 200 to 600 is a very wide interval. So that's the point I was mentioning, that we do not have a robust, reliable estimates of snow leopard population size. And even the estimates that I mentioned just now, the global and the India one, they are more informed guesswork, more like an guesstimate than an actual estimate. And that's a situation we are trying to change. That's a situation the government of India is also trying to change under the National Project Snow Leopard, but it's going to take long because it's difficult, it's hard to do it.
So quite a few people have asked, including somebody talked about Spiti Valley, is that what's the effect of tourism and this crazy snow leopard photography or the desire for a snow leopard picture? What are your thoughts on that?
That's a difficult question, but I believe, I don't think there's an issue in people wanting to see snow leopards and wanting to go to the mountains and enjoying and having adventure and fun. The problem is when you don't do it ethically, when you don't worry about the species you are interested in, when you don't worry about the habitat you are going into. So if you do it respectfully, with respect to the species, with respect to the habitat that is important for snow leopards and the people, if you do it with respect to the culture of the local people, I won't see it as a problem. But you know, I don't know, you have different kind of tourists going into mountains. There are people who are very, very well aware of what they're doing and they're very cognizant of their responsibilities. But you also have people who have very little respect for either the mountains or the wildlife or the people living up there. And they do create problems. So seeing snow leopards is difficult, but it also brings a lot of value to the local economies. In fact, many local communities in Ladakh and in Spiti Valley are benefiting from snow leopard related tourism, but it has to be done sustainably and it has to be done very carefully.
Yeah, great. So I think a few questions are also pointing towards is that as a spirit of the mountains, what's the role that the snow leopard plays and what's the role in the ecosystem?
All right. So snow leopard is in fact the apex predator of these high mountain systems. This is the top predator. And of course, like in any other system, a top predator has a ripple down effect because it kind of balances the entire ecosystem. So if I must say, snow leopard is like the pulse of the mountains. It's an indicator species. Wherever you have snow leopards, you can be rest assured that the habitat, the mountains, the ungulates, and even the people and the livestock would be doing fine. So it's a pulse, it's a barometer of the mountain systems, being the apex predator.
Great. I think there are quite a lot of other questions coming in. A gentleman is asking about government initiatives, and whether a few other questions are also asking whether snow leopards are safe in India as compared to other countries.
Okay, so there are two questions. So far as government initiatives are concerned, the government of India had launched a national project snow leopard way back in 2008. Unfortunately, it was never implemented in letter and spirit due to several reasons. But now the government has picked on it again. And now there is again, the ministry has started implementing the National Snow Leopard Project. And there are two components in it. One is to develop robust estimates of snow leopard population size. Other is to have really good informed conservation planning for snow leopards. That's work in progress. So far as safety of snow leopards is concerned, there is a lot of variation. I mean, even if you look at the Indian Himalayas, there are some places where hunting and poaching does occur. But there are other places where local people will not allow any hunting poaching to happen. They won't allow even any outsider to come and hunt or kill snow leopards or ungulate species. And I think the local culture, the Buddhist influence does have an important role to play there. So just to contrast, so if I were to compare snow leopards in India and Mongolia, I would definitely say snow leopards are much safer in India because no one is going trying to catch them and put snares in snow leopard habitat, barring a few exceptions here and there. So they are.
Yeah, a question connected to that, and somebody is asking repeatedly, is that whether the Dibang Valley project that has been recently proposed for clearance in Arunachal Pradesh, will it affect snow leopard conservation? Will it be in the snow leopard habitat?
I could be mistaken, but so far as I know, I think the larger impact of that project is going to be, unfortunately, is going to be on tigers. Because that's a very important tiger habitat. It's not so much of a snow leopard habitat, in fact.
Okay. But snow leopards are also impacted by construction of linear infrastructure and tourism-related infrastructures. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, so these impacts are pervasive now. I mean, this is happening all over the world, and it's happening in our country also. Government has its own concerns. Because these are all remote, high mountain systems. They're all very close to international borders. So there is a push for developing better infrastructure for people as well as for the armed forces. And that is having an impact on snow leopard and mountain systems. And I don't know if we can push back and stop it. I don't think that's possible. But what can be done is to do it in a manner that it has minimum possible impact on snow leopards and their habitat. That's something we are trying very hard. And in fact, Dipankar is someone who has tremendous experience on linear infra and he's working on those issues. So we are working very closely with all partners and government agencies to minimize the impact of these kind of infrastructure activities. But I don't think there is any way we could stop there. But at a larger scale, what is more worrying is what is happening with the One Belt and Road project. That's huge, and that will have tremendous implications for snow leopards.
Sure. A couple of people have asked is that for new entrants in the field of wildlife conservation, what are the opportunities? What are the different careers one could look forward to? Not exactly a snow leopard career, I'm sure, but I think a general wildlife career, if you may say so.
Well, I don't have any specific advice, but I must say that if you're passionate about wildlife, there are indeed existing and emerging opportunities. It's never easy because conservation at times can be very disappointing because you see more failures than success. So you have to be really spirited to be here and remain sane and keep working for the cause that you believe in. But I think it also have its own rewards and the sense of satisfaction that you get by doing something that you love doing. And I think in our country, there are more and increasing and emerging opportunities for wildlife first. So if you are interested, definitely this is a path to look forward to.
Rishi, a very interesting question, which says, a gentleman says that your research and distribution showed a wide range apart from Hemis and Spiti Valley, including Uttarakhand. Are there any recorded sightings from other locations in the Western Himalayas?
So there are, if you can see my slides even now, so I'll go back to illustrate that point. One second, sorry. So sightings are happening all across the Himalayas. You know, there are, as more and more people are going in the Himalayas now for tourism and adventure. So if you look at this map, for instance, and this Himalayan arc, you do have snow leopard sightings all across the Western Himalayas. People have seen snow leopards in multiple areas. But these sightings are typically beyond 3,000 meters, not below 3,000 meters. What I was showing actually is on the map that I was showing is not about the sightings, but about the research projects that have happened, research programs that have happened in snow leopard terrain. And those hotspots indicated where more research has happened, not snow leopard sightings per se. This one, I believe, was a confusing one. So what this indicates is wherever any researcher, be it an ecologist or social scientist, have done any work on snow leopards, sightings would be widespread, definitely. You will have more sightings.
Yeah, thank you. I think questions are kind of, most of those are covered. Nikhil,
would you like thank to you, Deepankar. Thank you, Deepankar. And thank you, Rishi, for such a enriching snow leopard tour for us. So thank you so much. And thank you everybody for joining in. And do join in tomorrow. We have some very nice talks happening. Tomorrow at 2:30 in the afternoon, we have Rajneesh Swarna, who will tell you how to identify raptors for dummies. And at 5 o'clock in the evening tomorrow, we have Carol Inskip talking about her trip to India in 1977 and how she came overland to India from the UK and birdwatched in India. So see you all tomorrow and thank you everybody. Bye.